Hello, you malty malt mentioneers, and thank you to Frank for that malt mention. Yes, we're going to review a whisky, you know, but I suspect you guessed that was going to happen. Here it is. This is Whisky Review 334, part of a little series on quality blends, and in 333 I reviewed Chivas Regal 18-year-old, and here in 334 I'm going to review Johnnie Walker Swing. Now, we're all familiar with the red label, the black label, the green label, the gold label, the blue label. These are quite famous, recognisable bottles of whisky. But the Johnnie Walker range extends a little bit further, and I'm going to come back to that shortly. But here's the swing. Some of you may be wondering, why is it called swing? Yeah, and we'll come to that shortly. But before we go anything else, tasting notes. Yes, very important. And a little drop of water in the whiskey. Not a lot, just a drop. It doesn't have an age statement on it, but I'm guessing that you're talking older whiskey, combination of younger and older whiskey, averaging about 15 years, because there's certainly some oldish oak happening in this particular dram. I bought this, in fact, no, I got it as a present from my pal Stevie. We were involved many years ago in a thing called Operation Rally, which took us to various parts of the world for big adventures. Yeah, indeedy. And we've stayed in touch, we've remained friends over many, many years. And when he was coming back from a trip to Dubai in the Middle East, Stevie picked up a bottle of this because he knew I'd probably appreciate it. Thanks, Stevie. I am not disappointed. Nose. A lovely, big, malty, fruity event. Fresh fruits and dried fruits. Intense on the nose, but soft. Certainly, I like quite a bit of maturity going on in here. Sweet and spicy malt, creamy vanilla, honey, some oak char on the nose, milk chocolate, cocoa bean, raisin, banana, fudge, some cherry stones in the background, adding to the complexity, and a certain fragrance. It's that little floral note of daffodil and lily. With a little bit of water added and giving it a few minutes, maybe 10 minutes, you'll get an extra spiciness, some tea, English breakfast tea, some extra raisin, and a touch of resinous content. Taste wise, always enjoy this bit. Steady, traditional tasting, sweet and sour malt arrival. You think it's going to be sweet, then you get that citrus sour note, hints of salt in there, and then the sweetness comes back again with a rich oak content. Deliciously complex maltiness, and this expands with barley sugar, fudge, mild mint, mixed spices, loads of spices in this, and some raisin banana kind of fusion going on, and more than a passing hint of bitter oranges. Bitter oranges as in Vanderhoof, the South African orange liqueur. With water, after about 10 minutes or so, you'll get some baked apple coming to the surface, becoming more apparent, along with tea and sultana. And the finish, good quality finish here. Vanilla, honey, tea, mild mint, a little bit of some dusty, slightly stale oak, but it does remain in the distance. It doesn't really impose too heavily. It doesn't base. It simply doesn't disrupt the pleasantness of the experience. You've got to look for it. And the finish with water involved, you're getting more bitter, dry tannins. So, a very well blended scotch. Very hard to spot the grain in here. You're getting a little vanilla. The vanilla kind of has a custard content, which would be coming from the grain, I presume. But such is the volume of malts in this and the quality of the marriage of the malts. It's a delightful, complex, traditional, blended Scotch experience, and it's worth, to me, 90 marks out of 100. And that, my merry maltsters, is a blend mark. Wonderful stuff. Any summary comments I'd like to make? An excellent, all-round, rich blend. If you can't find Green Label, look out for this one. You'll find it at airports in what they call duty-free, although it's not really... duty-free is not what it used to be. But the airport liquor shops tend to be good places to find less ordinary whiskies, and the experimental whiskies that the producers like to put out and test in the market, because, of course, at airports you get a really good cross-section of consumers from all around the world. That's why the whisky industry likes to put in these new whiskies and test them out in the airport markets. On the nose, I think I'm picking out Cardhu, to be honest. Is of all the single malts, Cardhu and to a certain extent Glenord. That's primarily what I'm getting. Of course, I could be totally wrong, but I don't particularly care because it's a lot of fun anyway. Speculating. Now, there's another thing I wanted to mention here, and we'll start off with the additional Johnnie Walkers that are out there before I go on to the swing story. Very interesting story. This well worth. Putting your feet up, relaxing in your cosy couch and lifting up another glass of whiskey. But the Johnnie Walker range. It's now the case that whiskey collecting has become such a major preoccupation with a lot of people that there are whiskey collectors who are specialising, and you will increasingly come across your Johnnie Walker collectors. There's the Chivas Regal collectors, there's the Ardbeg collectors, there's the Bladnach collectors, people who are specialising on getting as many bottlings from one distillery or from one blend brand. And certainly the red label is very easy to get as Black Label. Blue Label's a little more expensive to get, though it's quite easy to get. But harder to get is the other Johnnie Walkers, and I'm going to introduce a few of them to you. I have one here. Here's the Johnnie Walker Premier. It's a variation on the theme of the component or recipe blends of the Johnnie Walker range. You've got the Swing, you get the excellent Swing Superior, you get the Premier, you get the Honor, Johnnie Walker Honor, very rare one, that relatively expensive and quite sought after at the auctions. You also get the teardrop shaped Deco, Johnnie Walker Deco. That was originally for the Taiwanese market, again relatively short lived, most of it drunk, and now collectors are looking out for it, as they are the Yellow Label. Johnnie Walker once produced a Yellow Label whisky, which basically the same packaging and presentation as Red and Black, but of course with a yellow label, obviously. They only produced about 100 or so. So those are highly sought after by Johnnie Walker collectors, as is possibly, arguably the rarest of them all, and that is the Johnnie Walker Liqueur. Now, it's unusual that liqueurs would be considered collectible, but the Johnnie Walker liqueur was so short-lived and just basically an experiment in the market, which they decided to discontinue, that it is very much one the collectors are looking out for. And increasingly, with people tasting old bottles of stuff on a more regular basis from auctions and from collections, they're finding that, you're noticing at auction that liqueurs from vintage times, you know, from the 60s, 50s, 40s, 30s, they're commanding big prices at auction, because when you've got sugar in the spirit, over time it will mellow considerably, and in a sense the presence of the sugar in the liquor will actually over time enhance the range of flavours and the experience of drinking it. So old whiskey liqueurs, don't let them go to your cart boot sale, your garage sale. Oh no, no, you hold on to them, particularly if they're sealed. They have to be sealed anyway. So that's a basic introduction to the more obscure versions of Johnnie Walker. And I'm going to conclude now with the swing story. Let's put this bottle away. I'll maybe review it some other time. We go back to the 1930s, between the great European wars, when there was a period of boundless optimism and incredible fashion. It was the age of Art Deco, and you had the Flying Scotsman, you had round the world solo aviators. Records were being set and records were being broken. And it was a time of luxury travel, and two of the greatest icons of the 1930s in this glamorous Art Deco period were the Atlantic going passenger liners. The French had a magnificent ship called Normandie, which really was, it was the fastest, most technically advanced, most exquisitely luxurious interior of any ship there has ever been. Old pictures, I mean, look it up online, old pictures, interior pictures of the ballroom in the Normandie are just incredible. And the British had a rival to the Normandie called the Queen Mary. And Queen Mary was amongst a very small group of ships which were constantly looking to set records for crossing the Atlantic between Britain and New York. Southampton, I think it would be, in New York. And of course the great whisky personalities and the barons of the time would be using these ships to cross the ocean in luxury, to which they were accustomed, to visit one of their biggest markets in the world, which was the USA. And one of such passenger in the ocean liner was a certain Sir Alexander Walker, who was one of the last generations of the Walker family, who founded the Johnnie Walker blended Scotch. And typical of people in the whisky industry, wherever they are, they will sooner rather than later gravitate to the bar. And they're not looking to buy whisky, by the way. They just want to see if their whisky's being stocked in the bar. You'll find that most people in the whisky industry, they chill out with a glass of gin and tonic, because if you're working with whisky all day, the last thing you want to do at night when you're relaxing is drink the stuff. So if you're ever visiting a distiller, never take them whisky as a present. Take them a bag of fresh ground coffee or coffee beans, quality stuff, so as it they can help them helps them to stay awake when their stills break down. But Sir Alexander was in the bar and probably mulling over his gin tonic, a Manhattan, whatever cocktail, I don't know. And he is looking at the bar and he noticed it was calm day. Big boats, they don't kind of pitch and toss in the sea. They're fairly steady. You know, in a calm waters, you'd hardly notice the ship was moving. You only get a kind of light background tremble of the massive engines in these boats. And he was looking at the bar, and he noticed out of the corner of his eye there was a bottle, and it was trembling and rocking, and it really bugged him. He thought to himself, you know, here's all these luxury, expensive whiskies at eye level, behind the bar, where everybody can see them, but that little bottle stuck away in the corner up there, it could have been tequila, it could have been rum, we don't know. And there it is, rocking and trembling and moving. All the other bottles are still, and this little bottle is moving. And it really, it clicked with them that for all the hundreds of bottles in the bar, there's that little bottle up in the corner that kept catching his attention. And he kept thinking about it. When he got back to Scotland, he went into his office, and of course, this is the age where one individual was the patriarch, the despot, there's no committees involved. He went into his office and says, right, I want a moving bottle. I want a bottle that can sit behind the bar in a ship and it'll move and it'll get noticed, and I want my whiskey in it. So his bottle developers and his blenders went away, and this is what they came up with. The Johnnie Walker Swing, which as you can see has a classic broad base, narrow neck, designed for ships, stability. And this is what they did. Basically, they produced a bottle with a convex base. Now, convex means it's bow-shaped, it's not flat. And it means that on any moving surface, you will get a little bit of rocking. And it makes it noticeable. I mean, we're now in the age with whiskies where they're now exploring bottle stands which rotate. Bottles with glass that glows, that's fluorescent. Bottles with stoppers, with little batteries and LEDs inside, so as it can light up the interior of the bottle. All these things are being designed. But do you know what? Back in the 1930s, this was cutting edge stuff. Fantastic. The only clue you get in the packaging is this 1930s liner on the back of the box. They don't tell you the story, and that's why I'm telling you this story, and I'm going to conclude this story, because we're not quite finished yet, because every big company has a big rival and they don't want to be outdone. So you've got the Johnnie Walker Swing, and Chivas Regal wanted something the same but different, and this is what they created. Very much a ship's bottle shape, except this one doesn't rock. Think about, I need my special base. I thought this would happen. You ready? It's called Revolve, Chivas Revolve. And there's a little dimple right in the centre, which on a flat surface, which we don't have in a barrel, allows the bottle to be spun like a spinning top. Isn't that fantastic? So, I do hope you've enjoyed this little vlog, where I do make an effort to provide that little bit extra information, so we're going beyond just mere tasting notes and mere marks. Oh no, there's a lot more to whiskey than that. You know, at times with whiskey, smell and taste is actually incidental to the experience, But more about that later. Thank you for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this vlog. I will be back again with Whisky Review 335. And I will be reviewing another quality blend. One that Ralphie recommended and one that is well worth buying. And I hope you'll care to join me. I'll certainly do my best to make it interesting for you. Bye-bye now, and sip slowly. You know that's sensible.